Hello, and welcome to our 2016 How Far Away Is It? Update. 2016 was another good year for expanding our knowledge of the universe. We'll start out in the solar system, where we had a solar flare. Mars reached opposition. The Juno probe reached Jupiter. And the Rosetta mission ended. Then we'll move out into the Milky Way, where Gaia has a major update for us. We'll take a look at some nebula and star systems, and we'll go into magnetars. I'll explain what a magnetar is. And then that will drive us into a deep dive into how we developed the Milky Way rotation curves with kinematic distance and radio astronomy in order to see through the core of the galaxy to what's going on the other side. Then we'll move out into galaxies beyond the Milky Way, nebula inside orbiting galaxies, some beautiful galaxies nearby and far away. We'll take a good look at a survey that has changed the way we view the number of galaxies that there are in the universe. We'll end with a segment on the Palomar Observatory. I went there this summer, and I was briefed on a new facility called the Zwicky Transit Facility, where they can map the whole sky in one night, do it again the next night, compare the images for anything that may have changed, do this all through the year, accumulate it, and share it. So that's very interesting, and we will hear more about the results of the Zwicky Transit Facility in 2017. So let's start at the center of our solar system. On April 17th, 2016, an active region on the sun's right side released a mid-level solar flare, captured here by NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory. The solar flare caused moderate radio blackouts. This video was captured in several wavelengths of extreme ultraviolet light and color-coded for easy viewing. On May 12, 2016, the Hubble Space Telescope captured this striking image of Mars. The planet was 80.5 million kilometers from Earth. This observation was made just a few days before Mars opposition on May 22nd, when the Sun and Mars were on exact opposite sides of the Earth. This phenomenon is a result of the difference in orbital periods between Earth's and Mars' orbit. While Earth takes 365 days to travel once around the Sun, Mars takes 687. As a result, Earth makes almost two full orbits in the time it takes Mars to make just one, resulting in a Martian opposition about every 26 months. The next one will be on July 27, 2018. NASA's Jupiter spacecraft arrived at Jupiter on July 4th, after a five-year journey. On August 27th, it successfully completed the first and closest of 36 planned orbital flybys. The spacecraft flew over the tops of Jupiter's clouds at a distance of just 4,200 kilometers. This photograph is the first flyby data to be released. It was taken from a distance of 703,000 kilometers. Juno is experiencing some propulsion and electronic difficulties. Hopefully, it will be fixed and continue to collect data on Jupiter's atmosphere, weather, magnetic fields, and formation history. at least until 2018. Then, the spacecraft is scheduled to plunge into Jupiter's atmosphere, taking measurements all the way in till it is crushed or burns up. The European Space Agency's historic Rosetta mission to the comet 67P has concluded with a controlled impact into the comet. The decision to end the mission was based on the inevitable. The Rosetta spacecraft was running out of power. Here's the collision course into the comet from an altitude of around 19 kilometers. Rosetta targeted a region on the small lobe of the comet, close to a region of active pits. Pits are of particular interest because they play an important role in a comet's activity. Transmissions continued up to the moment of impact. The comet is now beyond the orbit of Jupiter and heading for the Kuiper Belt. It will return with Rosetta's wreckage on board in 2021. Moving out to the Milky Way, we have an update on Gaia, the spacecraft that's recording information on over a billion stars. In 2016, Gaia produced the most detailed 3D map ever made of our Milky Way galaxy. It has pinned down the brightness and precise position on the sky of 1,142,000,000 stars. This past year's data release also includes the distance and motion across the sky of more than 2 million stars. This map shows the density of stars observed by Gaia in each portion of the sky. Brighter regions indicate denser concentrations of stars, while darker regions correspond to patches of the sky where fewer stars are observed. The dark lines are artifacts of the collection process. They will disappear once more data has been collected. The image clearly shows the structure of our galaxy with its core, disk, and halo. Darker regions across the galactic plane correspond to dense clouds of interstellar gas and dust that absorb starlight along the line of sight. As Gaia rotates and captures the light from stars around us, it also sees orbiting and local group galaxies. Several are visible in this image. You may remember from our How Far Away Is It segment on globular clusters that they are the backbone of our galaxy. A significant number of them are visible here. You can see them spread throughout the central part of the halo. Open clusters are also visible. Note how they tend to occupy volumes closer to the galactic plane and are further out from the core than the globular clusters. Let's take a look at some of the Milky Way objects photographed by Hubble this past year. Here, we're zooming in to a glittering open star cluster that contains a collection of some of the brightest stars seen in our Milky Way galaxy. Called Trumpler 14, it is located 8,000 light years away in the Carina Nebula. Because the cluster is only 500,000 years old, it has one of the brightest concentrations of massive luminous stars in the entire Milky Way. These blue-white stars are burning their hydrogen fuel so ferociously that they will explode as supernova in just a few million years. The combination of outflowing stellar winds and ultimately supernova blast waves will carve out caverns in nearby clouds of gas and dust. These fireworks will kick-start the beginning of a new generation of stars in an ongoing cycle of star birth and death. Here's a 2016 photograph of the Bubble Nebula. It's a balloon-like bubble, 7 light years across, being blown into space by a super-hot massive star. An extremely bright, massive, and short-lived star, that has lost most of its outer hydrogen and is now fusing helium into heavier elements. The star is about 4 million years old, and in 10 to 20 million years, it will likely detonate as a supernova. It is responsible for ionizing the entire region. In this clip, a virtual camera flies through the foreground stars and approaches the central bubble. The three-dimensional perspective emphasizes the extended nature of the structure and the fact that the star is not located at the center. The computer model incorporates both scientific and artistic interpretations of the data. In particular, distances are significantly compressed. At the center of the Crab Nebula, a pulsar blasts out pulses of radiation 30 times a second. This Hubble image captures the region around the pulsar. It is centered on the region around the neutron star, the rightmost of the two bright stars near the center of the image, and the expanding filamentary debris surrounding it. Inside the shell is a blue glow, that is radiation given off by electrons swirling at nearly the speed of light in the powerful magnetic field around the pulsar. Bright wisps are moving outward from the star at half the speed of light to form the expanding ring. It is thought that these wisps originate from a shock wave that turns the high-speed wind from the pulsar into extremely energetic particles. This stellar system resembles a globular cluster, but it's like no other cluster known. A team of astronomers found that there are two distinct kinds of stars in Terzan V, which not only differ in the elements they contain, but also have an age gap of roughly 7 billion years. The ages of the two populations indicate that the star formation process was not continuous, but was dominated by two distinct bursts of star formation. While the properties of Terzan V are uncommon for a globular cluster, they are very similar to the stellar populations which can be found in the galactic bulge. These similarities could make Terzan V a relic of a galaxy formation representing one of the earliest building blocks of the Milky Way. Zooming into the center of our galaxy, Hubble reveals a rich tapestry of more than 500,000 stars in the core's nuclear star cluster. This is the most massive and densest star cluster in our galaxy. Astronomers estimate that about 10 million stars in this cluster are too faint to be captured in the image. The distance between stars in this region is about a half a light year. Our last inside the Milky Way object is a magnetar. A magnetar is a spinning neutron star with an intense magnetic field. Magnetic field strength is measured in units called Gauss. A refrigerator magnet is about 50 Gauss. MRIs use up to 70,000 Gauss. A magnetar's field strength is 1,000 trillion Gauss, enough to tear atoms apart at 1,000 kilometers away. Only around 1 in 10 neutron stars start out as magnetars. We do not yet know what makes their magnetic fields so strong. But it looks like they don't last long. They settle into normal neutron star status after around 10,000 years. On June 22, 2016, an instrument aboard NASA's Swift telescope captured the release of a short burst of X-rays from 1E1613, a star in the middle of the supernova remnant RCW103, indicating that it may be a magnetar. Seeking to investigate further, Astronomers had the Chandra X-ray Observatory and other telescopes follow up with observations of their own. They confirmed that 1E1613 has the properties of a magnetar, making it the 30th magnetar ever discovered. One of the most fascinating aspects of magnetars is how they can have starquakes, earthquakes, but on stars. When neutron stars form, they can have a crust on the outside surrounding the matter inside. This crust of neutrons can crack, like the tectonic plates on Earth. As this happens, the magnetar releases a blast of radiation, like the solar flare we saw earlier, but millions of times stronger. In fact, in 2004, the most powerful starquake ever recorded came from a magnetar called SGR-1806-20. In a tenth of a second, one of these starquakes released more energy than the Sun gives off in 100,000 years. This wasn't a supernova. It was a centimeter-wide crack on the magnetar's surface. The newly launched SWIFT satellite, which was designed and built to detect gamma-ray bursts, not only saw this blast, but was so flooded with energy, its detectors completely saturated. This enormous wave of energy was so powerful, it partially ionized the Earth's upper atmosphere, and it made our magnetic field ring like a bell. And all of this came from an event on the other side of the galaxy. This is an image of the galactic core. The magnetar is located far behind it and cannot be seen because of the density of stars and dust in the core. Compare that to the distance of the Orion Molecular Cloud Complex, 1,500 light years away. It's a little disturbing to find out that a centimeter-wide crack in a magnetar's crust can impact our atmosphere from so far away. To understand how we calculate that the magnetar SGR-1806-20 is 45,000 light years away, deep inside the hidden zone, we need to take a look at how kinematic distance calculations and radio astronomy were used to develop the Milky Way rotation curve that we discussed in our 2015 update on dark matter. The best way to map out the rotation curve for the galaxy's disk is to measure the orbital velocities and distances of gas clouds and star-forming regions across the galaxy. These are the H1, H2, and molecular clouds we covered in our segment on star birth nebula. These are the best objects to analyze for three reasons. One, they trace out the spiral arms, like we see here with Andromeda. Two, we can see them clearly at great distances using radio astronomy. And three, there is a good way to calculate their distance for the inner part of the galaxy. We need radio astronomy because stars are not good candidates for building a galaxy-wide map. This is because we cannot see stars in the plane of the galaxy's disk beyond 6,000 light years due to the dust in the interstellar medium. The dust absorbs and scatters the light that passes through it. The further the light has to travel, the more of this dust it encounters, and the dimmer it gets. This is called extinction. But gas clouds radiate radio waves, and radio waves pass through dust particles untouched because their wavelength is much larger than the size of these particles. We can see these clouds all across the galaxy, including the hidden area behind the central bulge. What's more, the hydrogen in these regions emit a spectral line in the radio frequency band, and this spectral line exhibits Doppler shifts, enabling us to measure the cloud's radial velocity relative to us. In this line of sight reading, we see a number of peaks. Each one represents a cloud. Peaks have different frequencies because the clouds have different radial velocities. The maximum peak is from a cloud that's radial velocity is close to its total orbital velocity. We can use the Doppler shift of dust clouds to find the kinematic distance to the object and calculate how fast it is rotating around the center of the galaxy. In order to convert this radial velocity information into rotational velocity and distance from the center of the galaxy, we use a technique called the tangent point method. First, we take a line of sight look for clouds. Having found one, we adjust the longitude to get the maximum radial velocity based on the Doppler shift. This will mark the cloud's closest approach to the center. At this tangent point, a line to the center will be perpendicular to the line of sight. Here, the radial velocity of the cloud will be equal to its rotational velocity around the center of the galaxy. We can calculate its distance from the center and its distance from us with a little trigonometry. So, for clouds closer to the center than we are, we can scan the sky bit by bit and create a map of the rotation velocity and distance for the inner galaxy. This map can then be used to find distances to all the clouds and the stars they contain, as long as they are closer to the center of the galaxy than we are. For clouds further out, there are no tangent points. For these, we have to use weaker methods for determining distance and rotational velocity. We then do a best fit line for the collected data. Here's a graphic superimposed on our galactic curve that indicates the accuracy of methods used to provide the included data points. The vertical lines through each point represent the range of possible velocities for any given distance. Notice that these lines are quite long once we are dealing with distances beyond one astronomical unit. For Magnetar SGR 1806-20, a number of astronomers have connected it to the giant molecular cloud Westerhout 31. Its longitude is 10 degrees. Using the rotation curve, it is estimated to be 45,000 light years away, give or take 5,000 light years. Going beyond our galaxy, Hubble captured two nebula inside the small Magellanic Cloud, situated as to appear as one. Intense radiation from the brilliant central stars is heating the hydrogen in each of the nebula, causing them to glow red. This is part of a study to understand how interstellar dust is different in galaxies that have a far lower supply of heavy elements. The small Magellanic Cloud has between a fifth and a tenth of the amount of heavy elements that the Milky Way does. Because it is so close, astronomers can study its dust in great detail and learn about what dust was like earlier in the universe's history. Astronomers using the unique ultraviolet capabilities of the Hubble Space Telescope have identified 9 monster stars with masses over 100 times the mass of the Sun in the star cluster R136. This makes it the largest sample of very massive stars identified to date. The detected stars are not only extremely massive, but also extremely bright. Together, these 9 stars outshine the Sun by a factor of 30 million. Eta Carina, the most luminous star system ever seen, is best known for an enormous eruption in the mid-19th century that hurled an amount of material at least 10 times the Sun's mass into space. Still shrouded by the expanding veil of gas and dust, Eta Carina is the only object of its kind known in our galaxy. Here's a small portion of the rough-and-tumble neighborhood of swirling dust and gas near the star. This close-up view shows only a 3-light-year-wide portion of the entire Eta Carina Nebula, which has a diameter of 200 light-years. Dramatic dark dust knots and complex structures are sculpted by the high-velocity stellar winds and high-energy radiation from the ultraluminous variable Eta Carina. Galaxy surveys have not found any Eta Carina twins, underscoring its rarity. But in a 2015 survey released in 2016, five potential Eta Carinas were found. This is one of them. These five objects mimic the optical and infrared properties of Eta Carina, indicating that each very likely contains a high-mass star buried in 5 to 10 solar masses of gas and dust. Further study will let astronomers more precisely determine their physical properties. A firestorm of star birth is lighting up one end of this dwarf galaxy. The galaxy is shaped like a flattened pancake, but because it is tilted edge-on to our view, it resembles a skyrocket, with a brilliant blazing head and a long star-studded tail. KISO 5639 is a rare, nearby example of elongated galaxies that occur in abundance at large distances where we observe the universe during its earlier epochs. Observations of the early universe, such as Hubble's ultra-deep field, reveal that about 10% of all galaxies have these elongated shapes and are collectively called tadpoles. But studies of the nearby universe have turned up only a few of these unusual galaxies. New observations from Hubble have revealed the intricate structure of the galaxy NGC 4696 in greater detail than ever before. Astronomers have found that each of the dusty filaments has a width of about 200 light years. These filaments knit together and spiral inwards toward the center's supermassive black hole that's flooding the galaxy's inner region with energy, heating the gas, and creating streams of heated material. It appears that these hot streams of gas bubble outwards, dragging the filamentary material with them as they go. The galaxy's magnetic field is also swept out with this bubbling motion, constraining and sculpting the material within the filaments. This Hubble Space Telescope view reveals thousands of galaxies stretching back into time across billions of light years of space. This image covers a small portion of a large galaxy census called the Great Observatories Origins Deep Survey, GOODS, and it sheds light on just how many galaxies there are in the universe. You may recall that the Hubble Deep Field and ultra-deep field views provided an estimate of 200 billion. But recent studies by the GOODS team found that in order for the small size of the older galaxies to add up to the mass of the larger galaxies in existence today, there must have been an additional 1,800,000,000,000 of them in the early universe. Unfortunately, the vast majority of these are too faint and too far away to be seen with present-day telescopes. But the James Webb Space Telescope, due for launch in 2018, should be able to see them. Our final piece for 2016 is on the Palomar Observatory in Southern California, operated by Caltech. I had the opportunity to visit the observatory this past summer. Palomar is playing a significant role in modern time-domain astronomy that studies how astronomical objects change with time, including everything from distant supernova to nearby asteroids. A transient facility is a complex combination of telescopes, fast wide-angle cameras, and rapid computer-based spectrographic analysis. We're detecting and communicating these changes. The Palomar Transit Factory, attached to the Samuel Ocean Telescope, has been doing this for years. producing millions of publicly available images. Now, a new facility, named the Zwicky Transit Facility, will see first light here in 2017. Its new camera will be able to examine nearly the entire sky in 8 hours. Its enormous 40-degree footprint makes it one of the most efficient cameras ever developed for mapping the sky. The facility was named after the famous astronomer Fritz Zwicky, who, you may recall from our 2015 update, was the first to discover dark matter. In the 1930s, he persuaded Caltech to build a telescope at Palomar that could capture large numbers of galaxies in a single wide-angle photograph. They did, and that's what he used to study the Coma Cluster, where he found the first evidence for dark matter. We'll check back in on his namesake successes in our 2017 update. Here are the links to Hubble and other locations where I found the information contained in this 2016 update. These are the places where you can go to learn more. And don't forget, every How Far Away Is It video, including this one, has a document with the text, pictures, links, and notes, located on howfarawayisit.com/documents. Thank you for watching.